How many of you are already published authors? Wow. Thank you. And how many of you have a dream of writing your book someday? Nice. And how many of you will not raise your hand no matter what I ask? Thank you. My name is Jyotsna Ramachandran, and today I'm here to talk to you about how to become a best-selling author in less than 2 weeks, even if you're self-publishing your book and you're not famous yet. Okay, so but before I begin, I would like to thank PSAI, Kriba Shankar, and the entire core committee for inviting me here, because it really means a lot. It means a lot to me. In the beginning of this year, when I was writing down my goals for 2019, one of my key goals was to become a speaker at an international conference, and I'm so glad it happened in the very first month of the year. Thank you. And I would also like to thank each and every one of you sitting here. Because you know what, there are two amazing speakers out there, but you chose to be here. So that means a lot to me. So please give yourselves a big round of applause. All right, so I just want to start with this. How many of, okay, give me a rough idea if you have. On an average, how many books do you think a self-published author sells? Not in a month or a year, but in the entire lifetime of a book. Any rough idea? Just throw some figures. 10,000, you're very optimistic, ma'am. Absolutely, you guys are close. It's around 250. That's the average number of books a self-published author ever sells, right? I hear people say that writing a book is like delivering a baby. How many of you have heard that? I think definitely a man only must have said this, huh? Because I have brought in two kids into this world, and definitely writing a book is not that challenging. Having said that, it does take a lot of effort to write a book. When you put in so much of effort, when you put in so much passion, and at the end of it, only 250 books sell, will that not be too disheartening for you as an author? And that's why I'm here to show you how can you sell more books and make your book a bestseller. So let me tell you what's going to be the agenda of my talk. We'll first look at why should you become a best-selling author? What is so great about it? What are the advantages? Then we'll see what does the term bestseller really mean? Because there's a lot of mystery around this term. You know, everyone says I'm a bestseller. So what does the word bestseller really mean? And then we'll see what are the different kinds of bestseller charts out there. And finally, I'll show you how to plan and execute your bestseller launch. All right? And if you have any questions that keep popping in your mind, please write it in your notebook and make sure to ask me at the end of the talk or during the breaks. Is that fine? All right. So now that I'm going to spend the next 1 hour with you, is it okay if I tell you a little more about my background? Thank you for your permission. So I'm the founder of Happy Self-Publishing. Happy Self-Publishing is not a typical publishing house. It's not a traditional publishing house. What we do is we provide services to authors so that they can self-publish their books. So that's what we do. And we have so far served more than 400 authors from 35 different countries. I'm not saying this because I have done something big. This was possible because of the online nature of my business. Because we work over the internet, we are able to serve people from across borders. You know, there are no geographies, no limitations. So because of the internet, because of the time and age that we live in now, this is possible. And I also love speaking at stages. That's one of my new, it used to be a hobby, now I'm going to take it up professionally after listening to all these speakers. I love making videos on YouTube. I have a podcast, I have a blog. And I do all this from the comfort of my home office right here in Chennai. So for me, one of the values that I really find important is freedom. So I have tried to create my own version of the freedom lifestyle I want, and that's possible only because I work from home. And that's my team at Happy Self-Publishing. We have 18 people in my team. You must be wondering, I work from home, so where are these people? So mine is a virtual team, and all my team members also really value this freedom lifestyle, because they all work from their homes from different countries. So isn't that amazing? Thank you. Yes, just park it in your notebooks and I'll answer it in the end. So that's my official team. And this is my team at home. So that's my husband, Girish, pretending to be Schumacher. And that's my daughter, Advika, and son, Vedant. Now, as a family, I think for me, what's my interest is I love dressing them up in different costumes and clicking pictures. So that's like a favorite pastime of mine. And together, we all love to eat at all the latest restaurants in town and experience different cuisines. And now when I eat so much, I need to burn it also, right? So I make sure I don't miss out on any of my Zumba classes, and I've recently started running as well. But more than all these things, what really gives a sense of fulfillment for us as a family is when we travel together and experience the world. Now, why am I telling you all this? Because I feel that today I'm in a position where I'm somewhere closer to the freedom lifestyle that I wanted to create, but this used to be a dream for me 4 years ago. So would you guys like to know what's the flashback? Ask me, what is the flashback? Okay, 5 years ago, I used to, that's exactly when my daughter was just born, I used to run 4 different businesses. Okay, I used to have a staff recruitment agency, I had a corporate gifting business, I had a web design agency, and my online publishing business had just started. So what do you call a person who starts one business after the other? Serial entrepreneur, right? But I was definitely not that. I was a desperate entrepreneur. So for me, because one business was not making enough money that it should, I just went on and kept on starting one business after the other. And over a period of time, I realized that I was under so much stress. So that was my business side of things. And on the other hand, I had a new baby, I was a new mom, I had zero experience handling kids. So it was a chaos in my personal side as well. But I always used to feel that there is one thing, one thing I used to feel good about myself is that I had successfully managed to quit a corporate job and I was trying to do something on my own. So I used to feel little, you know, nice about myself. And I thought that I had the knowledge that I should share with all those people working in a corporate job, working in a 9-to-5 job, and they're not happy. So I wanted to share that with them, though my life was not perfect. So I thought that I must write a book. Okay, so one thing that I would say is writing a book has changed so much. Now, definitely at that point of time, I was not a successful entrepreneur by any standard. But I definitely felt that I was a couple of steps ahead of all those people who are stuck in a job that they don't like. So I felt that it is my duty to share what I have done with them, and that's how I wrote Job Escape Plan. So if I had to attribute, you know, one thing to that has completely changed my life in the last 4 years, it would be this book. The book went on to become a number one bestseller in Amazon under several categories. It was in fact ahead of some of the all-time bestsellers that I have grown up reading. So that was a, you know, huge aha moment for me. And it also got featured in Inc.com as one of the top 10 Start Your Business books of 2015, next to books of Guy Kawasaki and all that. Yeah, so this is something which I never expected, but because of this, I was able to position myself as an expert. And soon, you know, people from the media, newspapers, magazines, radio, they all wanted to interview me. I was like, really? I mean, I couldn't believe it myself. And I got opportunities on stages like TED and all that. So now when I reflect upon my life, I realized that with a little amount of success that I had, just because I wrote a book, it gave me so much recognition. So I started wondering that there are so many people around me who have great life experiences, who have so many important messages to share with the world, and they all want to become authors. They come and ask me, how did you write your book? So I decided to, you know, put my resources together and help them out, and that's how I started Happy Self-Publishing 3 years ago. So now my mission has become to help 5,000 people by the year 2020 to establish themselves as experts in their industry by helping them to write and publish best-selling books. And that's why I'm here, and I'm really humbled because indirectly you are all helping me in accomplishing my mission. So thank you so much for that. Give yourselves a round of applause. All right, so let's dive into this. So first let me tell you, why should you become a bestseller? What is so great about it? Is it really worth your time? So in my opinion, becoming a bestseller helps you in 2 ways. The first way is it helps you gain visibility. Okay, why visibility? Why is visibility so important? Now every year, there are at least 1 million new books getting published. That's a lot of books, right? That means every minute, 2 new books are coming out. So if you don't do any marketing about your book, if you think that, okay, let me be humble, let me be modest, let me not talk about my book, then nobody is ever going to find it. And it's going to be lost in the jungle of Amazon, and nobody will ever find it. And that's why it really becomes important that you do a launch promotion, that you do a bestseller campaign, so that right at the beginning, your book gets that momentum. You know, it's like the fuel that a rocket needs to go up on space, and then if the rocket is well engineered, it will automatically take off. But you need that initial fuel, and that's what a bestseller campaign can do for your book. The next thing about why you should become a bestseller is for the credibility. Now, if you've seen all the speakers who've been speaking, all of them are introduced as best-selling authors, right? And I predominantly work with speakers, trainers, coaches, and consultants, and they all come back to me and say that after they wrote their book, they are able to charge a higher consulting fee, they are able to attract better coaching clients, they are able to book more speaking gigs, and that's the magic of a book. So instead of just being a published author, you can definitely aim at becoming a best-selling author. That badge really matters. So that's the reason why you should also try at becoming a bestseller. Now, let me talk about some of the myths. People think it's a very big deal to become a bestseller, and I have come across a lot of misconceptions around the concept of becoming a bestseller. So I'm going to bust three myths that I keep hearing. The first one is people think only books written by famous people can become bestsellers. Now, if you are a J.K. Rowling or you're a Chetan Bhagat in India, then you know that these guys already have a huge readership. So the minute they announce a book, everybody's excited and their readers go and pre-order the book. The minute it's launched, people rush to bookstores. So automatically it becomes a bestseller. But that doesn't have to be the case for everyone. Even if you're a first-time author, you can still become a bestseller. If you see the book that I have circled there, it belongs to Dr. Lata Vijayabhaskar, who is our core committee member and my client. So last week we ran a bestseller campaign. And to her surprise, I of course expected this, but she was surprised when she saw that her book on difficult conversations was ahead of Chris Anderson's TED Talks, Michael Port's Steal the Show. So these are people whom she was looking up to, and now her book is selling more than theirs. So this is not just possible in a few categories or few topics. It's possible for every category. These are some of our clients. So whether they are writing a book on leadership, on success, on project management, or how to lose weight, or how to make more money, whatever be the topic, even if you're a first-time author and nobody knows you yet, if you do the right things, you can still become a bestseller. So I just want you to understand that the person sitting next to you can become a best-selling author, and the person sitting in your own seat can also become a best-selling author. So turn to the person next to you, give them a loud high-five, and tell you are a best-selling author. Okay. Now, I see some people pretending to be invisible. They're not looking right. They're not looking left. Okay, so let's do it once more. Why I'm telling you to do this is when you say it, you start manifesting it. So tell loudly, tell with confidence, you are a best-selling author. Lovely. Thank you, guys. The second myth about becoming a bestseller is people think you should sell thousands of copies to become a bestseller. Again, this is not true. Because I have seen authors who have sold thousands of books and yet they have not reached the bestseller charts. And I have seen authors who've just sold a few hundred books and they have become a bestseller. So how does this work? Now let's look at it as a running race. Now if somebody asks you, if you have to become the first person to finish the race, what should be your speed? Okay, don't you think that's a weird question? Because more than your speed, what really matters is if you're faster than the other people running the race, right? So your speed does matter, but it doesn't matter as much as the speed of the other people running the race. Similarly, you should see whether, are you going to compete with Usain Bolt, or are you going to compete with the kids running in a school race? So that's what really matters. You need to decide which bestseller chart am I trying to compete in, which bestseller categories am I trying to compete in, and then plan your strategy according to that. So I believe that your strategy is more important than sales. Please repeat after me, strategy is more important than sales. The third myth I want to bust here is people think that bestsellers means they need to keep selling forever. Like perennially, they have to be bestsellers. That, again, that's not true. If you look at the books here, right on top of the book, you see words like number one New York Times bestselling author or USA Today, Wall Street Journal bestseller book. So what does it mean? Does it mean that these books are currently on those charts? No. Even if they have been on those charts just once, that author has the right to claim that he's a best-selling author, right? So you don't have to always, at all times, keep selling thousands of books. If you touch the chart once, you have the authority to tell that you're a best-selling author. So please remove this notion that I need to all the time keep selling thousands of books. That's not necessary. So now let's go and look at what exactly are these different bestseller charts that I was talking about? Now, there are, every country has its own kind of bestsellers list. Every newspaper comes up with their own rating. But the most credible and the most respected ones are these four. Okay, Amazon bestseller charts, the New York Times bestseller, Wall Street Journal bestseller, and USA Today bestseller. Globally, these are recognized and respected. Now, in my opinion, out of these four, the most difficult one to crack, any guesses? No, Amazon, I'll tell you today how to do so. New York Times is the most difficult, okay? So, yeah, so why is New York Times most difficult? Because it is actually like a mystery, you know, how they make that list. They partially look at the sales figures. And by sales figures, what I mean is they have chosen some bookstores, some retailers in the US, like Barnes & Noble, and they've chosen some online bookstores. It's more or less like your TRP rating for TV shows. So they don't take the full number, but they've taken a sample from different stores, and that gives them an idea about the sales, but it doesn't stop with that. On their board, they have some people who decide if the book is good enough to be on the chart or not. So even if the book sells thousands of copies, if the board decides that it doesn't have to be, it won't feature. So it's really difficult to crack that code and get into the New York Times bestseller. Now let me tell you about Wall Street Journal. Wall Street Journal is again a magazine, and every week, so all these guys come up with a list every week. So what does Wall Street Journal do? They have something called a Nielsen's book scan. So that's all, that purely depends on sales, so it's more predictable. So if your sale is good, you automatically get featured in the Wall Street Journal. So every week they come up with a list of 10 books under different categories. The next thing is USA Today. That's also similar. They look at Nielsen's book scan number, but they come up with a list, come up with a list of 150 books every week. Now, for most self-published authors, these are like a dream, because for traditional publishers, your book gets to be inside bookstores. But for self-published authors, it's very, very difficult to have your book inside a bookstore. And that's why even if they have a huge audience and they sell a lot of books online, because they don't have offline presence, they miss out on this chance. But 6 months ago, a friend of mine, she's an author called Alinka, she gave me a call, and she came up with this idea that, Jyotsna, let's do an experiment. It's very difficult for an individual self-published author to reach these charts, but why not collaborate with several authors and create some, you know, magic? So this is what we did. Alinka and I and 26 other authors, so there were 28 of us totally, all of us have been publishing books and have a decent amount of experience in the self-publishing business. We all came together to write a book called Write and Grow Rich. So each of us contributed one chapter and we put together as a book. But our collaboration was not just for the writing, it was also for marketing. So each of us have our own audience, our own followers, email lists. So we were marketing the book like crazy in our own circle. But what we did was, instead of just publishing the book and then marketing it, we put it as on pre-order on Amazon and all the online retailers like Nook, Kobo, iBooks. So we put it on pre-order, and for 2 months we were promoting it. So people were buying it for the lowest price, 99 cents, and they were purchasing it, so the sales were happening. So the day we launched it, it was in October 2018, the day we launched it, Amazon and other retailers aggregated the sales and showed this, and they showed the sale on one day. So whatever effort we put for 2 months, all 28 of us accumulated, and it showed up on the charts on one day. And we were so happy when we finally reached the USA Today bestseller charts. And not just that, what came as a surprise bonus is we didn't hope for Wall Street Journal, but we came in the number 6 position in Wall Street Journal as well. As you can see there, Write and Grow Rich. So, thank you guys. So, what I'm trying to say is nothing is impossible. Yeah. In those 2 months, we sold about 9,000 books. Yeah. So, again, that was only possible due to collaboration. So these things are possible, but today let me talk to you about what is more practical, what each and every one of you can do and can achieve. If your book is already out there, then within the next 2 weeks, you can implement what I'm going to share and become a bestseller. How many of you would like to know that? Thanks. So let me talk to you about Amazon bestseller charts. Now, if you click on any book in Amazon and you scroll down, then you will see something called the product details. Look down further, and you will see something called the Amazon bestseller rank. Okay, so this is how it will look. This is actually the screenshot from Dr. Lata's book. So if you see, there is something called, 3491, that is her overall rank in the entire Kindle store. Okay, Amazon has an ebook store called the Kindle store. So how do they rank it? The book that sells the maximum will be book number 1. So that will be like a Harry Potter or something, right? And the other books will be, yes. But this was in the Amazon.com store. So every store will have their own list. Okay, so Amazon has more than 10 stores. There is a .com, .in, Canada, Australia, different stores. So this is the international .com USA store. So this was her overall rank, okay? Now for you to become number one, as I said, you need to write like a phenomenal book, like something that's already as popular as Harry Potter. Those are the books that will reach the top 10 in the entire Amazon store. But what's more achievable for us as a first-time author is to become number one in at least one of the categories. So apart from the overall Amazon store, you also have categories like fiction, non-fiction, under fiction, you have business. Like her book went on to become number one, as you can see, in business consulting, in public speaking, and parenting as well. So that is something that's really achievable. If you see it, if you click on the book, inside the categories, it'll look something like this. So her book is at number one, and you can see it's under the top 100 paid. And next to that, there is another thing called top 100 free. So books that are available for free will be in the free store, which is more easy to achieve. But what's little more challenging and needs little more strategy is to be number one in the paid store. Now, even if you are, if your book is number 100 in some category, it is still a bestseller, technically. But my suggestion to you would be put a little bit of extra effort and you can actually be number one in any of these categories. So that's something. Exactly, I'm coming to that. So there are people, I'll come to that a little later. So next to the book, you also find some, when you click the book, you'll find this orange badge. You must have seen in several best-selling books. What exactly is this orange badge? What I have seen is, if a book is consistently at number one for a few days, Amazon recognizes that and gives this nice little bestseller orange badge. And that's something nice for an author to have, because you can put that on your resume and everywhere else. Okay, now let me tell you about the exact bestseller campaign and how we do that. So that's when I'll answer your question as well. Okay, so I'm going to break down the bestseller campaign into three stages. The pre-campaign activities, during the campaign, and post-campaign activities. Because there are a lot of things you need to prepare before you run the bestseller promotions. All right, so the first thing is the pre-campaign. So before you start running these promotions around the book, you need to do a set of things. Now, if you say in sales, it's all about traffic and conversion. Do this along with me. It's all about bringing the traffic with your actions, please. Bringing the traffic and get the conversions. The same applies for selling your book on Amazon. So during our promotions, we are going to get the traffic in. But what if the traffic comes and your book doesn't convert well? So you need to prepare the book for conversions even before the launch. So what we do is, the first thing, I'm going to take you through the mindset of a typical buyer on Amazon. If somebody clicks your book, what is the first thing they will notice? The cover design, right? So when you design your cover, make sure it's professionally done. Don't try to go to Canva and do it. I mean, you can do it if you have great design skills, but otherwise, just get it done through a professional designer. Make it look neat and clean and professional. And make sure that your title really stands out. Now, some people create this very artistic cover. It may work when you pick a book in a bookstore, but it doesn't work on Amazon. Because in Amazon, when people are searching for books, your book will be like a little thumbnail. So when it's as small as that, your title should still be visible. That's why make the title really big and bold. And when somebody clicks on the book, make sure that the subtitle talks about the benefits of reading the book for the author. I see a lot of authors writing books on their personal life, their journey, like a memoir. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you're a speaker, then you need to appeal to your target audience, right? And target audience actually doesn't care too much about your life, unless like you're a Barack Obama and people are really curious to know about your life. Nobody really cares about what has happened in our life, unless it has some connect with their life. So your subtitle should actually be talking about what are the benefits of reading the book for the author, for the reader. So that's really important. And the next thing that people will look at in your page is going to be this, the book description. Once people like the cover, they want to see what more has this book has to offer. So that's when they'll scroll down and read the book's description. Now, again, I see a lot of authors make this mistake. They just write a two-sentence bio about the book. Actually, Amazon gives you enough space to fill in two paragraphs about your book. So make use of that space and really write a good write-up about what are the benefits of reading the book? How is this book going to solve the problem of the target reader? and use bullet points, use highlights to actually make this more appealing. If you have some extra bonuses to offer in the book, if you have some interviews featured in the book, mention all of that. And towards the end, in the last line, give a very compelling call to action. Tell them, scroll up, hit the buy now button, because unless you ask people to take action, they're just going to browse the next book. So have a compelling call to action statement at the end of your book description. So this is another thing you need to prepare in the pre-campaign stage. The next thing that any browser will look at is the reviews. Today, do we buy anything without seeing reviews? Even to go to a restaurant, we want to see Zomato, right? So the same applies for your books also. People will definitely look at the reviews before buying the book. So what, as an author, how can you prepare yourself? You need to make sure that as soon as your book is launched, you get at least 10 reviews. Okay, 10 looks easy, right? But it's very difficult. You think your friend will write, your mom will write, everybody is busy and lazy and nobody will write. So you need to actually, yeah? I have tried everything, nothing worked. So my book has more than 150 reviews now and none of them are my family members or friends. So how do you do this? You need to create a launch team. So a launch team is a set of people whom you enroll into your book launch even before your book is launched. So a few weeks or even a few months before your launch, start talking about your book on social media. When you come to events like these, talk about your book and request people to be a part of your launch team. Now, why do people want to be doing that, right? Everybody is busy. See, if they are fellow authors or if they are speakers and trainers, they actually want to know the behind the scenes. You know, have you seen the behind the scenes of movies? Everyone wants to know how the shooting happened, right? The same is for a book. People are curious to know the entire process of what you went through. So recruit people into your launch team, add them to a WhatsApp group or a Facebook group, and every week just give them small updates. Like, you know, these are the three titles I have for my book. What do you think works? And people love to give their opinions, so they will be engaging with you. When you start designing your cover, show them the options that you have. Ask them to vote on the covers. When you're going to interview people, post those pictures. So people are engaged and involved in the whole process. So the minute you launch your book, they'll be happy to leave a short review. And again, you need to teach people how to write a review. You know, I've seen people write, this was a good book. You know, those kind of reviews don't work. So actually tell them, what are the three things you learned from my book? Please write about that. What is that one action step that you found useful in my book? Please write about that. And actually give them the links. Make it super easy for them so that they just have to click a link, type a couple of sentences, and the review is done. So make sure you get at least 10 reviews before you plan your bestseller campaign. The next thing that a browser on Amazon will look at is the pricing of the book. Okay, so to make it easy for them to buy, you have to price your book at the lowest. So Albert, what we do in our campaign is we have an 8-day promotion. Okay, now this 8-day is not a thumb rule or anything. By trying and testing different methods, what I have come to understand is this 8-day is sufficient to make your book a bestseller in both the free store as well as the paid Amazon store. Okay, so what we recommend doing is for the first 3 days of your promotion, keep your book at zero, like give it away for free. Why would you do that? Because you want your book to be in the hands of maximum number of people, right? There is no harm in giving it away for free. So for the first 3 days, give it away for free, let it climb the charts in the free store, and then for the next 5 days, give it away for 99 cents. That's the lowest price you can keep your book at. So make sure that all this is set up before the launch. Now, whatever I'm talking about is for the Kindle book. Any idea why not for the paperback book? Yeah, it costs, right? It costs money. You have to print the book. So there is a certain amount of cost involved. So you can't price the book below a certain price. Kindle store. So whatever pricing I just mentioned is only for the ebook. It doesn't apply for the Kindle book, nor does it apply for the audiobook, because Shoa will be sharing with you about that as well. So in the audiobook, Amazon decides the price of the book based on the duration of the audio. So you don't have too much of control over that. But what you can control is the price of your ebook. So that's the pricing strategy we suggest. Is the free Kindle book. Yeah. Just for 3 days, followed by... If you have something, just, you know, if I don't answer by the end, then please ask me, okay? So for 3 days, run the free promotion, follow it up by a 99-cent pricing for the next 5 days. The next thing people will look at is the author bio. Do you recognize this guy, by the way? Yeah, he's my husband. Okay, I'm not putting here putting his slide because he's my husband, okay? So he's actually the author of this book called The Marriage Mantra. So while I was making the slide for the presentation, he was peeping into my laptop, seeing what I was doing. And then he started, planning something because he has to take care of the kids while I'm here for 2 days, right? So to return the favor and, you know, to be kind to him, I thought, okay, let me add his book instead of some other client's book. So when you're preparing the author bio, many readers want to know who has written this book. Because this is a new author, I don't know anything about them. Why should I buy their book? So make sure you write a nice author bio that not just talks about the book, but about you, about what you do. How do you help people? Put your social media links, put your website details, so that people get the confidence that this person has the authority to write this book. And very important is your author picture. Make sure you click a professionally shot headshot photo and have it there, you know, not a selfie that you've taken on your phone. The next thing that people will see is editing and formatting. Now, you may wonder, how can they see the editing before they buy the book, right? But a lot of people have this habit. Exactly, they click on this look inside button that's right above the cover to just check the first few pages of the book. And if the first few pages are bad, they're not going to buy. So what's very important is that the editing is done really well, there are no typos or anything, and it's well formatted. Now, whatever I'm saying right now is with the assumption that you're all are going to write high quality, valuable books, okay? So there is no compromise on the writing. So if the book is bad, if it is a crappy book, then even God cannot save it. Okay, all these campaigns will actually work against you because if the book is not good enough and you end up doing all these promotions and thousands of people buy it, whether it's for free or paid, then they're going to really feel disappointed and they're going to run back to Amazon and leave a negative 1-star, 2-star reviews, and you don't want that to happen, right? So writing a bad book is like, and doing a bestseller campaign is suicidal. Yesterday somebody was asking me, can this be done for any book? Yes, the campaign can be done for any book. But if the book is bad, then it's not worth the effort. So first make sure that the book is great, and then you follow all these steps. So once you have all this ready, now is the time to actually execute that 8-day campaign that I was talking about. The first thing is like, you know, the first hack that we do is something called promotional websites. Now, how many of you already have your huge email lists of 50,000, 1 lakh people in your email list? So some of you have, but many people don't have a ready-made audience to buy the book. So what you do is you make use of other people's audience to buy your book. So in the United States, there are several websites like these. I've just put a few logos here. So what these guys do is they have a huge email list of 1 lakh, 5 lakh people, and these people are all regular readers of Amazon books. They are people who are regularly looking for new books and discounted books. So what we need to do as authors is, during those 8 days, we need to do something called promo stacking, okay? I call it promo stacking because every day in those 8 days, you'll be promoting your book in several of these websites. You'll keep stacking one promotion after the other. And what you do is you contact these websites and request them to feature your book in their websites. Several of them are free websites. There are some paid ones also, but they are really value for money because they give you that many sales. All right, so how will these guys accept your book? That's where the pre-campaign is really important. If you set up your book right and they feel that your book is good by looking at your Amazon page, they will accept your book. So you need to schedule those campaigns during those 8 days. So what happens on the day of the promo, they will send an email to their list. They will feature your book on their social media pages, on their websites, so that people, there are several people who are going to look at the book, but those who resonate with your topic will end up clicking and going and buying the book. So that's how the sales numbers increase on Amazon. The next thing is Facebook groups. There are several hundreds of free Facebook groups, and there are like 50,000, 1 lakh people in those groups. So you need to manually go and submit your book to all these groups, and people who are again interested in your topic will end up buying it because your book is at a discount. Now, this may not be your actual target audience for your book. They will eventually buy your book after it becomes a bestseller. But to make it a bestseller, you need to make use of the other, even the discount seekers, you know. There are people who will buy anything that's available at a discount. So you need to make use of them to at least make sure that you have get the enough number of downloads. The next thing I was mentioning is your email list. Don't underestimate the power of your own email list. Schedule several emails. Like on day one, you send a mail saying, hey, my book is available for free today. And on day two, send another mail to people who don't open the first day's email. on day 4, you send a mail about the 99 cent promotion. So plan something like this. Now, when I wrote job escape plan, do you know the size of my email list? Zero. Because I didn't start anything, you know, related to the online business I do. So what I did was, I interviewed 7 people in my book. There were 7 experts. One was a blogger, one was a podcaster, one was a YouTuber. So I had interviewed 7 people in my book, and they obviously added a lot of value to my book, but other than that, they just told me one thing. Just let me know when your book is out, I'll make sure I'll share it. So I definitely informed them the day my book was available for free and for 99 cents, and they were kind enough to share my book with their audience. And as a result, I got thousands of downloads from them. So if you're writing a book and you feel you don't have a following already, don't worry. You can interview a lot of famous people in your industry, and they will obviously be more than happy to support your launch. Why? Because they are also, you know, getting featured in your book, and they want to tell the world that, hey, I've been interviewed, right? The fourth thing, which I think is the most important hack during the 8-day, is choosing your categories. Now, listen to this very carefully. Even if you do everything else that I tell you, and you don't choose your categories well, your promotion will not work, and you will not hit the bestseller charts. So in my opinion, this is the most important strategy to make sure your book hits the bestseller charts. So how do you choose your category? When you're publishing your book on Amazon, there is Kindle Direct Publishing. That's the website you use, KDP, to publish your book. Inside the KDP dashboard, you get to choose 2 categories for your book. And usually what authors do in their hurry to publish their book, whatever category comes to their mind or whichever they see first and they see as relevant, they just go ahead and click that. Now for my book, if I had chosen entrepreneurship or business as a category, I bet I wouldn't have hit the bestseller charts, because if the same week, if Elon Musk's book gets published, people are going to buy that or people are going to buy my book. So if you are a first-time author, please don't choose a very broad category. Instead, look for the smaller subcategories. Like I chose home-based business and small business as subcategories for my book, so that it's less competitive and you have a chance of hitting the bestseller charts. Now you asked me, what if the category is not relevant? So there are some people, just for the sake of becoming a bestseller, they will choose a category that has only 5 books. So obviously your book will become a bestseller, right? But in my opinion, that's not a great idea. Because for example, if I am publishing a book on online business and there is some weird category, say, which is not relevant to my book on candle making or makeup techniques or something like that, just because the books over there are not selling well, if I put my book there, automatically it will be in the number one position. But I'll be showing my book to an audience who has not come to that category to buy that book, right? So it's actually doing injustice to them, and they are anyway not going to end up buying the book. So it's not a good idea to choose an irrelevant category. So just remember 2 things. Choose a category that's less competitive by choosing a subcategory, and the subcategory has to be relevant. Now, do you guys want to know one more ninja tip about choosing the category? Ask me, what's the ninja tip? Okay, this is something which I've not told before. I only reveal this to our clients. So what we do is, most authors think that I have only 2 categories to choose from, and they just settle for the 2 things that they think is good. But actually, if you write to Amazon's support email, you just ask them and request them that please add my books to more categories. You just choose the categories you want and write them an email requesting them to add your books to more categories. And I have seen that 9 out of 10 times they oblige and they actually add your books to more categories. So how does this help? You have better chances of hitting the bestseller charts because now your visibility is more, you're inside more categories, right? Like my book is under 10 categories now. But most authors don't know this, so they don't do this. So make sure when you're publishing your book, or if you already have your book, go to your Amazon dashboard, contact Amazon, and ask them for adding your books to more categories. All right, so now by running this 8-day promotion, you are already getting a lot of downloads. And by the way, did I tell you this? Amazon works very differently from all those weekly charts. Okay, why is it easier in Amazon? Because Amazon updates its bestseller charts every 1 hour. So every 1 hour, if you refresh your button, if a different set of books have sold that hour, those books will climb the charts and the other books will go down. So that's an advantage. That's why I recommend not to have this promotion as a 30-day promotion. Now let's say you have a certain budget. Don't spend it for 30 days. Instead, you know, like crunch it and spend it within a week, so that you can get more downloads. Like the momentum is higher, the velocity at which your book sells is higher, so that you can quickly climb the charts, right? So that's something which a lot of people don't do. They just feel that I should have a long promotion and they spend the entire money for about a month or two. That's not needed. If you can just bring it short and finish everything in a week's time, that's a lot more effective because Amazon keeps updating the charts every hour. So at least for a few days, if your book is at number one, you earn that orange badge. So that's the back end behind Amazon. So once you do this, now some authors will be very happy. Okay, fine, I've got the bestseller. I'm more than happy. Now wherever I go, I'll tell I'm a best-selling author. But there are some authors who are not happy with just that. They actually want real people to read their book, to get the information, to get inspired by the message, and get real feedback from people. So if that is your aspiration, then you should not stop with bestseller. You should continue to market your book, post the campaign, so that the book continues to keep selling thousands of copies. So let me share some of the things. Actually, you can do thousands of things to market your book, but some of the things that have really worked well for me and my author clients are these. The first thing is a podcast tour. Okay, in the afternoon, I'm really excited about the podcast session because podcast tours have really helped me. Now, what is a podcast tour? You must have heard about book tours, right? Authors going to multi-city, they go to different bookstores and they launch the book in Delhi, Chennai, Mumbai. So that can be done if you have a huge budget and a huge PR team backing you up. But if you don't have that, then completely for free of cost, you can do something called a podcast tour. Now let's can anybody volunteer and tell me on what topic they're planning to write their book? Yes, Sangeeta?
Finance for entrepreneurs.
Finance for entrepreneurs, right? So what you need to do is go to Apple's iTunes store, where all the podcasts are getting hosted, and she has to search for finance, entrepreneurs, these kind of keywords she needs to use to search for relevant podcasts. And you'll find hundreds of podcasts because podcasting has become a rage. It's yet to pick up in India, but it's like huge in the West. And they actually love having Indian guests on their show because it shows diversity and that alien factor is there, right? So approach all these podcasters. There are, and why people will want you on their show? Because podcasters are all the time looking for interviewing new people. So you need to approach them, tell that, hey, I'm the best-selling author of this book, and I share these three strategies in my book. And I think that's really relevant for your audience, and I can add a lot of value by coming on your show. So if you tell them, I'm going to come and sell my book on your show, nobody's going to call you. So you need to first give and then ask. So give value by telling them, these are the topics I can speak on. And towards the end of the show, they will ask you, so is there anything else you would like to talk about? Then you open your mouth and talk about your book. So that really worked well for me. I went on a dozen different podcasts when I launched my book, and it gave me a lot of visibility. And there are, for me, talking comes more naturally than writing. Though I have a publishing company, writing is still difficult for me. So if you're like me, go for podcasting. But if you're like Nina ma'am, who's an excellent writer, then what you need to do is start blogging. So if you don't have a blog already or you're just building your blog, contact all these established websites in your industry and offer them that you can write a guest blog for them. So that way you write for their audience and in turn, for example, if your book has 10 strategies, share 2 in the blog and tell for the rest of the strategies, go, buy this book. So that way you're indirectly promoting your book and also adding value to them. So the first one is podcasting and guest blogging. The second thing which I really urge all authors to do is have your own website. Have your own author website. Now you may be a trainer, you have a different website for your training company. That's totally different, your business and consulting. But also focus on the author part of you and start putting out regular content. Now we have like a content calendar so that, 1 month I put a lot of content and then next 6 months I don't do that. That won't give you traction. So make sure you have a content calendar and you can choose what kind of content you want to put. If you're good at videos, do videos or podcasting or blogging. Choose one medium, but do it consistently. By doing that, you're constantly growing your audience because you're putting it out on your website, then you're going and sharing it on social media, on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, everywhere. So people will find you from there, come to your website, consume more content, and finally they'll end up buying your book. So it's definitely not like overnight success. If you want to really promote your personal brand as a speaker, as an author, then having your own content marketing in place is really important. The next thing that has been working really well for authors now is Amazon ads. Okay, so how does Amazon ads work? Now people find your book through categories, but they also find your book using keywords. Now if you want to buy a book on personal finance, I'll just type personal finance and the entire list of books comes up, right? So usually that's how people find books on Amazon. So for your book to be found, what you need to do is promote your book using these keywords inside Amazon. So when I'm finding a book, under the book, I will find a lot of these sponsored items, sponsored books related to that book, right? So this is how people look for other books. So if you want your book to be featured under somebody else's book, for example, if my book is on finance and I feel that anyone who's reading Rich Dad Poor Dad or who is reading Robert Kiyosaki's book should buy my book also, then I put those books as my keywords. So anyone who's searching for that book will end up finding mine as well. You will also find these ads. Yes, Amazon ads are paid. So like Facebook ads, you give a daily budget and that's how it works. And you will also find it in the list. Apart from under another book, you'll also find among other books. Like when you search for it, you'll get an entire list of books, right? So the first book that you see there is written by my friend Akash Karia. So Akash is a global speaker and he has written several books on public speaking. So yesterday I was just trying to find public speaking, and even before Chris Anderson's TED Talks book, his book showed up. And as you can see, can you see the word sponsored on top of that? So that shows that his book is appearing, not because his book is selling more than Chris's book or it's more relevant, but it's appearing because he has paid for it, right? So these are certain things that you can do on an ongoing basis to maintain your sales. The next thing, of course, is Facebook ads. Now, I won't recommend Facebook ads for everyone. Now, if you have some kind of a business related to your book, then Facebook ads is really profitable. For example, if you have an online course or you're promoting an online summit that's related to the book's topic, or you have some coaching or consulting service that you want to promote, then what you can do is you can run a Facebook ad like these guys and you can actually give it for $1 or even for free. So people would love consuming free stuff as long as it's related to them. They'll click the ad, buy the book, and then as soon as they buy the book, you can offer more like the higher value services that are paid. So if you have something related to the book that's your business, or even if it's your speaking business, you can still promote it using your Facebook ad. And finally, because all of you are speakers here, you must really make use of this opportunity. So once your book becomes a bestseller, start promoting yourself, approach every association, every organization that's relevant to your market, and start offering speaking gigs. Now again, if you're not yet a professional paid speaker, that's okay. You can do, I have seen authors, you know what they do? They say that I'll come to your college, I'll come to your company and speak for free. All you need to do is ensure that each participant buys a copy of, you buy a copy of my book and gift it to your participants. You know, this is how they say. So, and they end up making more money by doing that instead of actually getting paid for that speech. So these are certain things that you can do on a regular basis so that you just are not a one-time bestseller, but your book continuously sells and remains a bestseller. Yeah, so when you want to approach a company and, or a college or any organization and speak at their event, and you feel that maybe they don't have the budget to pay you as a speaker, but you have a book, right? So your book is your tool. So what you tell them is, it's okay, like I would love to come and speak for free, but I would recommend that you buy my book and gift it to all your attendees because that's a nice takeaway for them and it's really relevant to the speech. So that way it's a win-win for all, right? All right, so finally I have a free bonus for all of you, okay? So take out your phones. What I'm going to give you is, I have right now spoken about the pre-campaign, during the campaign and post-campaign activities that you need to do, right? So I have put this up as a two-page PDF checklist. So all you need to do is go to askjyotsna.com. So that will take you to my Facebook Messenger and just type the words bestseller checklist. Okay, type this and you'll immediately get that PDF. So that will keep that handy. So whenever you're ready to run your bestseller promotions, you can refer back to that. So I would like to conclude with a, yeah, so you just go to, no, you just go to askjyotsna.com, it will redirect you to my Facebook Messenger. So inside the Messenger, just type bestseller checklist and it will give you the PDF. Okay, so some closing thoughts before I conclude and let Shua take up the stage. Now, I have been working out in the gym, okay, for the last 6 months, and I love to observe people in the gym. It's really hilarious. So I came across, usually, there are four kinds of people, not just in the gym, but in life as well. The first kind, I call them DKI, okay? DKI are people who don't know it, okay? So they're not having the awareness. They don't know what to eat, which are the best things to do. So they end up making wrong decisions, poor food choices, poor lifestyle, and as a result, they don't get the results they want in life. Okay, so that is the DKI. Then there is a next category called DDI. Any guess what DDI is? Don't do it, right? So don't do it. It's even more dangerous than don't know it. Because at least don't know it is blissfully ignorant. They don't know what to do. But this don't do it, guys, they actually know what to do. They know it's important to keep the alarm and wake up, but they will snooze it and go back to sleep and they won't go for that running. So this is a very dangerous category, okay? Then there is a fourth category. Third and fourth category. I really like these two guys because these two guys are actually the action takers, you know. In the gym, they'll really be sweating out. So DIY, as you all know, do it yourself. So these people love doing everything by themselves. They will do all the research, they will Google it, they will watch YouTube tutorials, and they will make mistakes, but they have no problem. They will learn from their mistakes and they will do it themselves. But my most favorite category is DIP. Any clue what is DIP? Do it professionally, bang on, amazing. So these are the guys who will hire a professional trainer, they will hire a dietitian, they will do all kinds of things to get the results. Why I feel these guys are smart is because they accept the fact that they don't have to know everything. And they also accept the fact that they can use their time for things that they are really good at and outsource the rest to people who are professionals. All right, so I very well know that you guys don't fall under the first two categories because now that you've attended the talk, you know, you already have the awareness, so you know it. And I'm sure you guys are all action takers, which is why you're attending a conference. So you're definitely going to do it. Now, I highly recommend that you do one of these at least. Either download that checklist and do it everything yourself. Okay, there could be some mistakes, but that's okay, but at least do it. Or you could hire a professional service agency like ours who will do everything for you. Okay, so that was my 5-second pitch about my company. All right, so don't forget to download this checklist. Thank you so much for your time. It's been amazing talking to you all. And ask me if you have any questions. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jyotsna.
Sure, 1 second. She has a question. Okay.
About the questions, we're going to have Shova talk about the thing. And then we can do our joint questions, if
Perfect.
You don't mind. Thank you.
Thank you.
Big round of applause, yeah. She's going to make us all bestsellers. Thank you, Jyotsna. Huge hacks. Now, I just want a show of hands. How many of us have read 10 books in the last 12 months? Great, great. So, I thought that number would be much lower, which is why I asked. So, many people aren't reading books anymore. They are hearing books. So, Shova is from Audible, the sponsor. And she's going to talk on the topic is books that speak to you. And she's basically from Mumbai. She has experience earlier with Philips, now with Audible. And she's a social media specialist. And over to you, Shova, to talk to us about books that speak to you. Give it up for Shova.
Hi, so unlike all of you here, I'm not a professional speaker. I'm so used to sitting in dark, dingy studio rooms. So I'm super nervous. The last time I was on stage was when I was in college doing a performance of The Mousetrap, and that was like easily like a whole decade or so ago. So this is very scary right now. And yes, I don't have a presentation. Apologies. I just came back from a very well-deserved and needed holiday, so I didn't really have the time to make a presentation. And also, I don't do presentations. I'm like I said, I come from the whole film and audio world. So please forgive me, but I have this, and I'm going to use it as my crutch. So we launched Audible in India in November, as many of you might know. And it's been really fun. We've been producing a lot of books in the last year. So so I've been with Audible for a year, and we've been producing a lot of books, and it's been really fun. We work with different studios in India. We actually have two in Chennai. And so I basically spend a lot of time in these studios. I used to work for films before as a production coordinator. So, and you know, it's a very different world. Like, you have films, which is very visual, and it's easy to get into a film, whereas with an audiobook, you are just listening the whole time, right? So you have to make sure it's very interesting. With films, you have, you know, really nice montages of like Chhatrapati Shivaji or, you know, like Bombay or Juhu Beach or something. Whereas with an audiobook, you don't have any of those crutches. So yeah, I mean, Jyotsna has told you how to write your audiobook and get all of that going. And if you choose to do an audiobook, book. And if you want to make your book in an audiobook, I'm going to tell you how you can do that. Once you've finished all of your business side of things, getting all of this organized with rights and stuff, you would get into production. And when you get into production, the first step would be finding a studio. So studios are very important places for an audiobook, obviously. But for a narrator, for an author who wants to make their studio, I mean make their audiobook, it's important to find a studio that they're comfortable with. So a studio that maybe understands the subject and understands how to get that going. Also language and diction. So sometimes, for example, when I was visiting a studio in Pune, their accent in Pune is obviously very Maharashtrian. And for a particular book, that might not work. So you would even need to like consider location when you're looking for a studio to do your audiobook, depending on accent, diction, all of those things, right? It's a place that, especially if you as the author are going to narrate your book, you're going to spend a lot of time in that studio, you know? So you need to be very comfortable with that space, with the team, with the engineer. And also some people would like to be in a place which is aesthetically pleasing. So, you know, there are some studios. I went to this one studio in Jaipur. I get in and it's just so dark. Like, I can barely see anything. And I was like, okay, this is really weird. Like, I don't think I could be, I'd be able to spend more than a few minutes in this place. So that's important. Even like smells and things. Like, how can you spend 5-6 hours in a studio if it has a very strong smell of something? So all these things, they might be small, they might be minor, but you would keep those things in mind when you're choosing a studio and a team to work with. You have to build a rapport and a connection with the team. Now all of that's done, and you have to choose. You have to figure out a narrator for your book. Now a lot of you are professional speakers here, and you might be able to like do a really good job at narrating your audiobook. But some people might not be comfortable with it. Might have, might not sound very appealing or very good. So you have to make that choice. Do you want to narrate your audiobook, or do you want to make sure that your audiobook is the best one out there? So you would either if you choose to narrate your audiobook, there's a whole lot of things that go into that. But it's important to serve the title with the best casting. So if you think you can't do the book, then you would ask a professional narrator to step in and do the book. So there was this one author. She we're gonna actually watch a video of hers later, her behind the scenes video. So she wanted to narrate her book. She was very excited about it, but we weren't sure if she'd be able to do it. So we asked her to send us an audition. So we sent her to a studio. She did her audition. At the same time, we also asked some other professional narrators to send in auditions. So when we got her audition, it was fine, but we weren't sold, And it's important to have the best narrator for an audiobook. It's difficult to tell the author that, okay, you don't work, but you have to do it because you are ultimately looking out for them and their product, right? So her thing wasn't great, but she realized that herself. She said, I'm not happy with it. Can I go back again and do it? So we'll be like, yeah, okay, sure. So she went back this time, and she also had somebody helping her in the studio directing her, which I'll speak about more later. So this audition that came back to us was really good. We were like, okay, this works. This is amazing. How did this happen? And but also keeping in mind that she'd already been in a studio before, like that previous time. She understood the process, so she was much more relaxed. So maybe now next time I do a speech like this on a stage, I'll be much more relaxed. There you go. Anyway, I'm going to like put this on Instagram and say, getting out of my comfort zone in 2019. So, huh? Oh, thank you. so, um, So basically she went in, she did a great job. We were like, okay, this is great. Let's have you narrate the book, because ultimately she is, it's her story to tell, which is so important. It's, you know, and also she was passionate about the topic and everything. So it worked really well. And she had a great time in the studio and everything. Also she was, she had really good diction and enunciation. It's incredible how much that is important for when you're listening. Then we had, time. So time is another big factor because, for a 300-page book, it takes 15 hours in the studio to just record it, right? So, you can't do one studio session, cannot be more than 3 hours, because after 3 hours, your voice starts sounding really drained and you are tired, your voice is tired, everyone's tired. So more than 3 hours in the studio is not recommended. Sometimes if there are professional narrators, they go on to about 4 hours or something, but after that even they stop. So now if you're thinking about that, that's like 15 hours, that's at least 5 to 6 days to go into a studio and record. Not everyone has the time, not everyone has the patience, so you have to have that. You have to have all those elements in place to be able to like get into a studio and do this. So we had another author, when we were talking about doing his audiobook, I suggested to him that, hey, you can do, you know, you can narrate it, you can audition for it. And he was like, oh, I didn't know that. And he was very excited about it. He said, okay, let me go try. And so he went into the studio. He had a really good time in the studio with the people and doing the whole thing. But then he came back to us and he said, look, I really don't have the time for this. He has like a full-time job and everything. And he's running his business, and he's like, I don't have the time to spend 3 hours for the next 6-7 days in a studio and stuff. So I'd like to, you know, just to do the preface or the author's note or some introductory chapters and have somebody else do the rest of the book. But he was very insistent on choosing the narrator as well. So usually we select the narrators. We don't always. I mean, there is like, you know, of course we give them that thing, but. He said, I want to I want to be able to select the narrator with you. And he said he specifically wanted someone who could speak in a South Bombay accent. So we were like, okay, great. So I thought that was really good for him to go into the studio to understand what the process is, because a lot of times, you know, you want to do your audiobook, but you don't understand the process, and then you go in and it's a whole big mess. So he made that step, he understood the process, he said, okay, I don't have the time for this, but I'd like to do a few of these things, and at the same time, I want a good narrator who can do, who can do a good job, but in a South Bombay accent and all of that. So that was one case of author reading his book. Then we have, so now once we're in the recording studio, we've got the recording sessions on, there are three people that make audiobook happen. One is, of course, the narrator. Second is the sound engineer, of course. Without him, her, we are nothing. And then there's the director. So not everybody has a director, and especially when you're a professional narrator, you think that, oh, you've got it all handled, and you'll be fine in the booth, you don't need anybody. But in my opinion, everybody needs a director, everybody. So, or if the engineer can double up as a director and engineer, that's the best case scenario. But there needs to be somebody who is sitting outside, listening to everything you're saying and like reading along with you, and making sure you're not missing out on anything. Because when you're just reading out loud, especially, you definitely will miss out on a word or a sentence or mispronounce the words or something like that. So there needs to be somebody outside who's checking on those things and making sure you're doing the right thing, because coming back later to do it, of course, happens, but it's best to just kind of control that situation in the studio, right? So for example, with pronunciations especially, pronunciations are a big thing, because first of all, India being India, with as many languages, as many people, as many dialects, pronunciations are all over the place, especially like, I mean, we've learned different pronunciations in schools. For example, the animal tortoise, right? My entire life, I said tortoise, because that's how we were taught in school. But just a few years ago, I learned that it's tortoise. Who would have known, right? Like, so it's, exactly. And also, preface. Now, preface is a word that's very important in audiobooks. Like, I listen to it every day. But it's, but everyone I know, including me, we said preface. And then, but if you look up on Google, on YouTube, on Merriam-Webster, on Oxford, anywhere, it's preface. So it's just the things we've been taught in school, which don't translate in our lives now, so we have to like be very careful. So even if you think that you know how a word is said, but if you have the slightest doubt, just stop right there and like have someone just Google it immediately and make sure you've got the right pronunciation, because somebody is going to pick it up in when they're listening to it. I mean, I do it all the time, and I'm just like, oh, they didn't do their homework, you know? So it's, you have to be very careful with that. So a director would do that. They would make sure that you're getting the emotion right, especially with fiction books, right? You have to make sure you're getting the emotion. It's really strange, like, you'll read a line, but you've completely missed, which is why homework is important. Coming to that, homework is really important before you go into a studio. You have to read a few chapters, you know, before you go and record them, because sometimes you're saying a sentence completely in the wrong context. It's supposed to mean something, but it comes out as something else because you haven't read the few pages before or after, so you don't know how that's going to work out. Exactly. Like, even like dialogue, somebody might say something, but he's being funny, but you know, so, and it's your job as a narrator to make sure you get everything right because you're telling the story, right? So you have to like definitely go in with homework. So storytelling is an art, right? And all these three people, they make it happen. They make your story come to life. So it's very important to have these three people in the thing, in the room. And with fiction books, it's sort of easy because, you know, especially when narrators are in there and they are quite experienced, you know, they can do character voices, and anyway, fiction is easier to like read and stuff. You know, nonfiction is not very easy always unless you're really interested in a topic. So how would you make someone listen to a nonfiction book, like get them interested, even though that's not their area of expertise or interest or whatever? So when I was in New Jersey, the Audible headquarters is in New Jersey. So when I was there, I spoke to this gentleman who has been narrating for like over 3 decades. He's a boss. And he started off as doing fiction books, but his voice was so good and he had such a great command that people started giving him nonfiction books more. Because like I said, it's easier to get people intrigued and interested in fiction books, but with nonfiction, you really need to have this power of engrossing people, which he did. So he started doing nonfiction books, and he kind of got stereotyped into nonfiction. But I asked him, I said, how do you make a nonfiction book interesting? So he said, you know, I imagine I'm sitting in a bar with my friends, and I'm telling them about the life of a bee over a few pints of beer. So that's what he imagines in the studio. That's the vibe he creates in the studio. So when you're listening to his book, you're his friend sitting in a bar over a few pints of beer listening to The Life of a Bee. So that always helps. Just imagine that you're maybe talking to a friend or, you know, something like that. Because it's not easy, especially for someone who's new at it. It's not easy to be in a studio trying to get the right feels and stuff. Also, I've noticed that when somebody, and I've noticed myself do this as well, so when you record, you suddenly get a weird accent. Like, you never had this accent before, but you're in front of a mic and you're just suddenly talking very posh. And I'm like, no, no, no. So I have to actually tell people, I'm like, no, no, no. Just talk like as if you're talking to me, you know, because suddenly it's like you're pronouncing words very differently. I don't know why that happens, but it's happened to like everybody. So we just have to be very conscious of the things we do when we're in a studio. So now once the audiobook is recorded, it goes into the post-production stage. The post-production stage is basically, it's very, very important, of course, and it comprises of editing, quality check, and mastering. So now, editing is basically, there are different ways studios record books. So some studios will do something called punch record, which is when you're recording. This is actually the most efficient way of doing it, in my opinion. When you're punch recording, you hit play and the narrator is narrating. Every time they make a mistake, you hit pause. You go back to the start of the sentence and you record it again. So this helps the editor. It's already kind of soft editing for them already. Then there are some studios that just hit play and then just record, and the narrator will make 500 mistakes. All of that is there, so the editor has to listen to each one of them, see which is the right take. That also means the director has to mark the script to say, okay, this was the like, the third version was the right version, or that kind of stuff. So editing is basically that. Editing is putting it all together and then just making sure your levels are fine and all of that. Once that is done, you do a quality check, which means you go through the entire book. Somebody from the studio will listen to the entire book and look out for mistakes. So mispronunciations, misreads, extra lines. This one time, this book was live, by the way. It wasn't done by one of my studios, I have to mention that. But basically, we got a review saying that, you know, in the book, you can actually hear the narrator saying, oh, damn. And that's not part of the book. He just like said, oh, damn, because he made a mistake and the studio forgot to edit that out. So that is something you can't afford to do, right? You have to like make sure you're listening to all of this. Which is why it's so important that, so like when you're doing English books, you have to make sure that you're sending it to a studio that's very proficient in English. Or someone who's, the person who's doing the QC is, knows, you know, everything. So so that they look out for pronunciations, they look out for these kind of things, and they'll know that, okay, this wasn't part of the book or whatever, right? So so that's what quality check is. You go through the entire book, and if you have any mistakes, then you'll call the narrator back and fix those mistakes and put that back in your track. Of course, there are things like mic sounds. Sometimes when you're, you know, when you're talking like this, you'll hit the mic stand. That sound will need to be edited out and all those things. So those things happen in the edit, quality check, and in the editing process. Then finally, there's mastering, which I haven't mastered myself. It's very technical, it's basically, mastering is basically a bunch of, it's about compression, and equalizer and limiter. Those are the three main things that go into mastering. Now, in compression, basically, these are good things for you to know, just so that when you do make your audiobook, you look out for these things as well. And just being part of the process is great, anyway. So compression is when, say for example, if I'm speaking really loudly because I need to like dramatize or something, or if I'm speaking very softly. These are very two different frequencies, right? But you need to have a consistent thing in an audiobook. This can't just be jarring. The difference will be very jarring. So the compressor has a threshold limit. So a very loud voice, loud noise, would come down to the threshold limit, and a very soft voice would come up to a threshold limit. So everything's on a, you know, same line. So that helps in just having a nice audio process, I mean, listening experience. The second was equalizer. Basically, an equalizer is, so some narrators will have a very nasal quality to their voice or something else that might be distracting. So with an equalizer, they're having a ball there. They need a compressor, yeah. So with an equalizer, what would happen is, I'm losing my thought process.
I know we have just 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I have a lot of questions about how it works commercially and things like that. So if it's okay, could we jump to that a little bit?
Yeah, I'm just done. I'm just done with this. So anyway, there's equalizer and then there's the noise reduction. So basically all these things that you do that. Also, I'm not the right person to ask about that, but feel free to ask me those questions. So anyway, with all these things, your audiobook is ready. And make sure you bring it out with all the feels and everything. So it's a great listening experience. And that's that.
Thank you, Shova.
Thank you.
Think, put your hands together for Shova.
Sorry? Maybe we can just finish the questions, and if we're done with those, we can play the videos.
Yeah, let's have questions. Please join Jyotsna, please.
So you could just quickly
when
ask
you ask your questions, please raise it to whom you're asking, and then
yeah.
So that
I work with Audible, yeah.
How does Audible charge on average for being page self-published
To produce, you mean?
Yeah.
So basically, with we don't charge like that. It's you have to like get the rights for it. That's a whole business aspect of things, which I'm not very good with. But yeah, you would have to get, Audible will have to get the rights for you and everything. And,
so help me understand.
Yeah.
Say I have a book published. So
yeah.
And I come to you and say I want to make it an audio book.
Right.
So then what is the process?
Yeah, you would go through the business team. So we would like, please feel free to take my contact, and if you have something like that, I can just pass you over to the business team because they handle all of that. My, I'm the production person, so I get the audiobook out, which means mine's the last stage. So for any of those other questions, it would be best if you just, you know, send me an email and I can help you to the right channels.
Can I just add a question?
Yeah.
Speak into the mic, please.
So one of the things is that Audible has very graciously going to be partners with PSAI, not just at the event, but throughout. So they are also actively looking for content. So most of these questions and answers, we'll probably try and come up with a session for one of the member meetings as well with other people. Today was more about getting to the business end of how to get it done on Audible and more of the technical aspects. But there are going to be people from Audible working with us throughout the year. You can either reach out to anyone at PSAI or to Shaw directly, and we'll put you on to the right people.
Yeah.
And that's also a process which is a little bit more unique to each one of you in terms of what you have. You are writing a book, you already have a book, so the answers will also be slightly varied.
Yeah.
But Audible is very excited to be working with the Professional Speakers Committee community in terms of getting this and coincides with their launch in India as well.
Yeah, I know they are very excited because, first of all, this whole topic of self-development and everything is like huge in India, so it's it's more work for us, so that's great.
Just to add to what Shoa said, these days, like in the last few years, most of our clients have been abroad, and there it's like a given. Like when you write a book, you put it as an ebook, as a paperback, and an audiobook.
Mm-hmm.
But only in India, it's just picking up. I think because Audible was recently launched, so I'm sure that's going to be really an additional source of revenue and followers for you because people are slowly shifting to the audio format.
My question is for Jyotsna.
Okay, one by one.
So if the book is not published with Happy Self, but the book is like the traditional publisher or somebody else, can you still do a marketing campaign for?
Yes, we have done that for several clients. The only
condition
is we need access to your Kindle dashboard.
Okay.
So I have seen that a lot of authors who have self-published it themselves, they anyway have access to it. And they give us access during that 8-day period. We run the campaign and give it back to them. But when you are traditionally published, in most cases, your publisher will have it in their dashboard. So we will not have access to it. We can't change the prices whenever we want. That is the challenge.
So that's something the author will need to have negotiated in the contract with the publisher even before he comes to you.
Exactly.
That the
Kindle
dashboard should be
If you speak to your publisher and work out a way to do it, then we can do it.
Okay.
Hi, Jyotsna.
Hi.
Is it possible to publish a ebook, Kindle books in Tamil? They are recently...
Yes, it is possible now, correct.
Now it's possible.
Yes, yes, it is.
Okay. Thank you.
And soon you'll be able to do audiobooks in Tamil as well.
Yes, yes. Of course, I'm so interested.
Jyotsna, this is again connected to your question. That is, already the book is published with another publisher. So can we run the same campaign by ourselves or is it good to go to a professional? The book is already there. So how do you go about it?
The only thing is you need to have the control of the dashboard. Like you should be able to log into your Amazon KDP account and you should be able to see the sales, change the pricing, change the category. So if in most publishers, what they do is, even if they are self-publishing houses, they publish it in their dashboard. They have their login. So you don't have, you need to speak to them and maybe make alterations in your contract and get it back to yours.
Can we do the campaign by
ours? Yes, you can do it. No, it's not necessary. That's what I'm saying. You know, it's a lot of time and effort that you have to invest in the whole process. Like right from, like in the checklist that I've given you, I have made a list of 127 promotional websites. Now that's a lot of work, right? Going and individually submitting. So if you have the time to do it, you can very well do it yourself.
One question, sorry, for Shoa.
Yeah.
If a book came out, say, 4 years ago, does it help in any way to go? I mean, it's actually for both of you. Do you think it'll be a helpful idea? Mine is traditionally published with Penguin. Does it make any sense for me to now do an audiobook, or is it kind of over?
You can do your audiobook whenever, it doesn't matter. And it's actually nice because once you've done your audiobook, you get to like have a new marketing strategy and kind of push it out there in a new format or whatever. So
that's what a lot of authors do. They first put out the ebook and paperback first, and after a few months they see the response and they make changes to their manuscript, and then they because audiobook takes some time, so they want to do it well. So they do it later. It doesn't have to happen along with the initial launch.
And also with audiobooks, you have the chance and the opportunity to have like a celebrity read your book or someone in that field of work do it. So there's a whole new way of getting it out again.
Would it make a difference if you want to go international with your book, audiobook, in terms of the Indian pronunciation and all those things?
So we stick to a British pronunciation because it's what Indians usually do. We don't use American that much. So I don't think, as long as you have a really good, clear voice and someone who is... So we always do an Indian neutral accent. So with neutral accents, it's usually easier. So there's no South Indian or North Indian elements to it or something. So it has to be neutral, which is why, it works.
That sells internationally.
Yeah. I mean, you should check it out on audible.in. Listen to some samples of books. There's one by Anand Neelkantan that is doing really well because the narrator is excellent. And he's actually just like in South Bombay. And he has a very neutral Indian accent. So I think it helps internationally. It does.
Shiva, this is to you. If I am interested in narrating my own book, what should I do?
All these things that I spoke about are for you, actually. It's just so you get an idea of how it's done. You would have to see, you'd have to do an audition and then listen to it and see if you fit the story you want to tell, the book.
I just want to know about the accent.
Because you're the author, it's totally fine. Because you're the author and you're bringing in your own thing to it, so it doesn't matter about the accent. You just have to be more clear and everything, and the director in the studio will help you. But don't worry about the accent because you are the author and you have every right to sound the way you are writing the book, so you should sound like the book. Yeah.
The author, we're using a sponsor's privilege after the last question. So please go ahead.
Thank you so much. Josha, I'm working on a book related to entrepreneurship mindset and entrepreneurship related myths. I'm slightly confused. Should I really go for traditional publishing or self-publishing? What are the pros and cons? How do somebody new like me should choose amongst these two?
I can do a one-hour session on the pros and cons itself, but let me just tell you briefly. It depends on what are your goals for your book. So 10 years ago, there was no option. Traditional publishing was the only method. But because of Amazon, now everyone has the power to publish the book on their own. So I see that many people go to traditional publishing for two reasons. One is they don't want to invest the money, because for doing all these things yourself, you need to invest in a professional cover, editing and formatting. These are the basics. So a lot of people don't have the initial investment to do for their book, so they go with a traditional publisher. That's one reason. Another is, of course, the brand name. People love to be published by Penguin, HarperCollins, that's one. The third is they would love to be in a bookstore. So usually it's easier when you go through a traditional publisher. But these days, how many of you went to a bookstore to buy a book? I have stopped doing that 5 years ago. So because all the sales happen online, even bookstores have a very different model now. They actually sell space to the publishers to display books. They don't make money by selling books. So that's how it has become. So that is a bookstore is another advantage. So and people think that traditional publishers can support in terms of marketing. But what I have seen is even people who are traditionally published, like a Chetan Bhagat, he does his own multi-city tour. They invest their own time in marketing. So if I feel that if you have the initial budget to produce your own book, like publish it yourself, and if you have the time and effort to market it, then please go ahead with self-publishing because you have total control over the rights, royalties, you can decide the price, you can decide everything.
Yeah,